So good morning to all of you, and I think this seminar actually was supposed to get over at 11:30. So I come here more or less, I'll try to finish my presentation faster and make my points. So after two excellent presentations, very briefly, I just want to bring you that, you know, this after my IAS as the secretary, IT secretary of the government of Karnataka. Then I took my VRS and set up these companies. One is Brickwork India, primarily the customers from different countries. Then Brickwork Ratings, mainly the Indian customers. So we are present in about 50 cities in India, which is a rating agency just like CRISIL and ICRA. Then we also started this BFA, like Banking and Financial Analyst. Now this is something which I think everybody tries to do this, because when you are hiring and you don't get the right kind of, you know, persons, you just hire depending on their profile, and then later on spend time in training them. And this is what is the BFA program that we do. And finally we do conduct exams, BFA level 1, level 2, like that. It's about a 1-year program. So this demographic dividend, I'll kind of skip this because a lot of definition has taken place. But generally, let's say one slide on Japan. See, 1950, if you see the, you know, their demographics, where you have a lot of children, and a lot of working people. So from pyramid, the way it is, it has become like a kite. Now in case of Japan, there are hardly any children and a lot of old people. Now old people means what? Old people means a lot of visits to the hospital. So there are a lot of general sickness because they are unable to do many things. And also nobody to earn. In fact, the way we spend, in fact, if you think of our healthcare expenditure, all of us spend 85% of our lifetime's healthcare expenditure in the last year of our life. That time you don't know that you are spending, you are in some ICU, something is happening to you. But whatever it is, everybody is in ICU maybe in the last year, and we spend 85%. Till then we never spend that money. So I think in the this kind of a demographics has already hit Japan, and you know their stock market since 1990 has never gone up, and those who lost their jobs in 1990 never got them back. So I think this demographic dividend is, in if we do not plan properly and if we do not give the jobs to our people, it can be a quite a disaster, because if you don't have the jobs, then there are no jobs. This is India's pyramid, 1950 the ideal one, 2050 a little bit, not very scary one, but little bit scary one. Because what happens is, most, see, for example, when we were there, I have 5 brothers and sisters. My parents had 10 or 11 brothers and sisters. You know, you people are, I think, perhaps the youngsters that I have seen, 1 child, 2 child, you know, only 2 children. And some people also are, many are marrying late. So finally there are not going to be children. And if the children are not there, there are not going to be any young people supporting you when you become old, which is not the case for us. We are that way lucky. So you keep that in mind. If there are no children, then nobody will support you later. If you think that your health insurance policy, etc. will support you, I hope it happens. But in India, as you know, the way the financial sector works, I have my own doubts. But whatever, so we are also heading towards the similar story, except we are lucky right now being the youngest nation in the entire world. Now, in fact, this point also was made by Dr. Shastri. Now, if you think of the new jobs which will come in the, you know, next 2000, and it is given in the next 10 years. In the next 10 years, Nobody will come from China. The China's addition to the labor is going down. But maximum 100 million will come from India. So wherever the jobs are created in the world, one in four job has to be an Indian, because the young people are right now here. Only thing is whether it will materialize just because we are young, whether we will get the job is what we need to see. For example, at present in India, this is a government survey, the people overall, only 60% are engaged full time. As it is, our statistics never reach everybody. So usually if government says 60%, you should add another 10%, 15%. 75% do not have full-time work, because that's the reality. And Dr. Shastri also made a point, are you studying your higher education just because you didn't get a proper job, you want to go for the higher education? And that is a truth also. Even in US, wherever there is a recession, the enrollments in the universities go up. Well, then people go and get one more degree and so on. So another point was made by Dr. Rajendran also on the employability, and my slide is also exactly the same. So less than 20% of engineers in India are employable. This is one of the survey. And in these also, this 20%, you should see the first one. For example, the first one is software engineer, IT products. So those who are hired in the IT product, they require higher level of skills. So the employability there is only 5%. In fact, the salaries are also extremely high. If you are an IT product engineer, you are looking at a starting salary of 15 lakh per year. That's a starting salary. But if you are looking at a general, for example, ITES or BPO kind of places, where in call center, etc., etc., the employability is 37%. The employability is very high, but the salaries are very low. So that you should, wherever the employability is extremely low, the salaries are very high. So that dilemma is also there. But technically, so I've given you different possibilities. You'll find the other place where it is 40%, associate, BPO kind of thing, I put here one. And software engineers, about 20%. But product engineers, 4%. Employability by gender. One encouraging point in the services industry is both men and women are employed almost 50%. So you can see across product categories, everywhere they are there, which may not be the case in some other industry, but as far as the services is concerned, it's somewhat gender neutral, and substantial number of women are employed. So that's one good part. But the employability continues to be low. The same men and women. Women in some places may be, you know, 1% higher and so on, but otherwise not much of a difference. This is the AICTE approves engineering colleges. Now he was also talking of the regulation. Now the regulation of the AICTE is also very funny. They will say you should have so much of area, so much of classrooms and so on. Nowadays you can get everything. Earlier they were specifying the library. Now you get all everything in Google. Students from 5th standard or 6th standard until they are postgraduate are completing their assignments on Google. I don't think they are reading anything else, but they need to read. That's a different matter. But here if you see the number of engineers, we used to have 5 lakh engineers in 2006. In fact, when I was IT secretary in 2000, it was even less. It was less than 2 lakhs. We have taken number of engineers to 19 lakhs per year right now. 19 lakhs. And the government of Andhra Pradesh gives licenses where you have a morning shift and a evening shift for the engineering degree. So you have a morning classes or you can go to evening classes in the same facility. And so that means they are doubling the number of engineers. So with so many engineers around, also it becomes tough to employ them. So the employability is also there. At the same time, somebody mentioned in the presentation, we need many, many more engineers in all the, not only engineers, in all the sectors, different sectors. And we need to produce many, because 80% of our higher education, I think Dr. Shastri said it was only in the undergrads. So these numbers are there, and these numbers also are one of the reason why people, the unemployability is an issue. So of so many colleges, you want to prefer students from only few colleges. Now, rising share of services. So services continues to become bigger and bigger. So it's going to become 63%. So that way, naturally, once that sector becomes bigger, it also requires more people. Now, this is the leading services segment. You know, this is the ITES. You have domestic $48 billion this year, $98 billion in the international. The domestic also will grow, this also, the international also will grow. Will grow means, I hope the government does something about the traffic, because recently Azim Premji had come to one of the sessions, hope he was there, and he was asked a question. Is it true that Bangalore is dying because of the traffic and so on, that people are not able to go anywhere? So he said, no, it is not true. Bangalore is already dead. There's no new company wants to come here. And I think it's not only Bangalore, wherever you go, there are a lot of issues. So we are unable to keep up with the infrastructure, very simple infrastructure we are unable to do. If one truck comes on our road, we all feel that, you know, quite miserable. A truck is there in front of your car. But for make in India is to produce in the trucks, and the goods will go only in trucks. So there are no roads where these roads can go, you know, the trucks can go. So the other phenomena which one has to keep in mind is workers on tap. See, earlier, for example, we have Uber. So we used to hire the taxi drivers. Now there is no need to hire them. If you hire them, of course, you have the employment restrictions, you have to give the provident fund, all kinds of issues are there, an ESI. Right now they are available. And you know, they already reached, Uber itself reached a valuation of $40 billion. So the workers are on tap right now in many, many sectors, not only in simple sector. But now what people are thinking, there is the drivers in the US whom they are employed, a lot of people will become unemployed. There aren't going to be more jobs as drivers, which is likely to happen here also. Now yesterday I saw, as I came out of the airport, Uber has announced a special rate to come from Bangalore airport to anywhere in Bangalore for 549 rupees flat. I usually pay 1200 when I come, you know, in some other thing. So I'm sure it will eliminate the rest of the companies and only Uber will remain later. But at least yesterday they have announced this new scheme in Bangalore. Now this freelance economy is not limited to drivers. There's about 53 million in US in various, you know, jobs. There are business owners, temporary workers, diversified workers, there are moonlighters, 14 million moonlighters. Moonlighters means these people are doing two jobs. One job in the morning and another half a job in the night, or sometimes full job, because the money from one job is not enough, which is also true for many Indians. So then automatically they try to do the second job. So when we do the employment statistics, we think you got a job, you got a job. But did you really get enough money is not really tested in the statistics. Now, whether we will get a job or robot will get a job is the next question. In fact, in most of the companies in India, the expansions, they have only been hiring robots. Robots have been getting installed in the auto companies everywhere. And that is why now, whether you manufacture in China, India or US makes no difference, because the robots are, you know, they can just work everywhere. perhaps better in US because electricity, etc., is there all the time. So this is one thing which also will put a huge pressure on jobs, tremendous pressure on jobs, because these robots will take away the jobs at the lower level where the maximum jobs are there. So now the advertisements will be, humans need not apply. It's only the robots which will be, you know, need to apply in some sectors. So there are 9 jobs that humans may lose due to robots. Because if the driverless cars come, then even Uber itself can be a problem, the valuation of Uber. Because then you don't need a Uber also. The car itself is good enough. But here are some jobs which people can, the jobs can go away. One example, the probability that a telemarketer's job will go away in the next 20 years is 99%. Now that's what the call center people do. Probability that an accountant and auditor's job will go is also 94%. Now mainly the auditors, why they are required? They are required only to talk to the income tax authorities, also to keep 2 set of accounts, so that for owner there is one set, for the taxpayer there is another set. If you decide there is only going to be one set, the software can keep your accounts. And once the software keeps the accounts, you don't need the auditors. And probably as the governments become more and more, you know, strict and transparent, so then probability that an accountant and auditor's job will go is 94%. So this the CA should keep in mind. Similarly, retail salesperson, because the mall themselves have problems. So you don't, you know, you want to do your self-research, you want to go to the mall just to check up what it is like and then go outside and order. I take the photograph of the book in the airport, then I order through Amazon. But I don't take that book because I have to carry that book. All my books are, I take it on the soft copy. Technical writers, also a problem, because a lot of MBAs later on get jobs called technical writers. It's 89% possibility of going away. Word processors and typists, machinists, even commercial pilots, because the way the US is sending the drones to go and bomb in wherever places in Middle East, etc., that same technology can be used to fly you from Bangalore to Bombay. Economists, since you people are studying commerce, keep in mind that the probability is around 43%. The only people who are, even actors, probability that they will lose their job is 37%, because we are enjoying the cartoon movies. So you can do a good cartoon movie, then why want an actor and pay him? The only jobs which remain, for example, the job which will certainly remain, recreational therapist, like a person who is a physiotherapy, massage people will remain, dentist will remain, because they have to technically see, you know, before they do something. So I think this is a huge possibility where the economy is going, and none of us will be able to stop it. So this technology is something which is beyond everybody. So still, in terms of jobs which are going, the college education is essential. So the low skill jobs are at the greatest risk, 70% risk of the jobs going away. But those who are better educated, there is a little less risk of jobs going away. Now let me just give you some starting salaries so you get a view. You are already aware of it, but just for example, if you are a graduate of IIMA, your starting salary is 17 lakhs. So these are all good institutes. Different IMT Ghaziabad, 8 lakhs, but I've given you a set of institutes which has come from somewhere this statistics has been taken, because not everybody reports their starting salaries, but together these kind of numbers are there. Similarly, CA salaries, accounting can be as less as 1.8 lakhs per year to 12 lakhs a year. So also taken from various. Comparative salaries of software engineers in startups Flipkart can give 10 lakhs a year. Now I don't know whether they will continue to give or not, but right now, at least in the last few years, it's good. But now people say Amazon and this, that are growing. But still, this time their campus hiring also a little bit come down, but they still give higher amount, so they get better people. So similarly, where if you see the top four Indian IT services companies, the top four means by number, they hire lot large numbers. They give only 4 lakhs. And I have to tell you, they used to give 3.5 lakhs in year 2000. So from year 2000 to year 2015, the salaries have gone up from 3.5 lakhs to 3.97 lakhs. So you can see that is because we were producing only 50,000 engineers. We are now producing 19 lakh engineers. So the demand and supply, it looks to me that there is too much of supply already in the country. I just thought a little bit about banking and financial because we do a lot with banks. I thought we'll give you some idea about this sector. And I will close with only this sector, IT and banking. So in banking, you can see the officers' jobs are coming down. See, the officers are going up. Officers were 28% going to 51%. Clerks used to be 50% going down to 34%. This is between 2001 and 2013, which has already happened now. So nobody is hiring the banking clerks and so on. So what happens is everybody wants higher skills. So the key is higher skills. Same, these are different banking segments. I'll skip this one. So 92% of the jobs in the banking are somewhat low skills. Only 5 to 8% of the jobs are specialist jobs. And these jobs are, for example, forex, risk management, corporate, credit, you know, some kind of analyst. All these jobs come here. You know, so that is where even economists also will come here. So what happens is, for these kind of good jobs are not available at the moment. And it's always the case everywhere, not only here. Any country, it is the same story. So you need, you know, the best jobs are always a problem. Now BFSI, of course, expected to create 1.3 million, but you should know that they will create more in, you know, slightly lower level, and only 8% good jobs. Job roles in skills in banking, similarly entry level, mid level, I leave that, but technically you require the better job. So I'm more or less coming to the end of the presentation, so I can confidently say I will close in the next 5 minutes now. Now I just given you these pictures, which is a marketing versus an analyst job. What happens typically in the banks is they hire a lot of marketing people. And these are all MBAs. They go there, probably they are, sometimes they are trained by some other institutions also. And then they finally get they take a loan, bank loan or whatever for that institution. They finally get a job in the bank, marketing job. So the target is, maybe let's say the salary is 4 lakhs. Then the target, you are given a target of 1,000 current accounts. The 1,000 current accounts you have to do in 1 year. In 1 year, there are 250 working days. So you have to do 4 per day. Okay. So 12:30 in the afternoon, you get an SMS, did you do your 2? And 5 o'clock, you get a call saying, did you finish your 4? So it's quite a stressful job where continuous. So they are treating the people like almost like a robot. So there are a lot of such jobs which happen. So marketing jobs in the entry level are always like this. Only if some people who have a flair for marketing and somehow survive this, and then later on, because the marketing people also can make a lot of money, the companies depend on the marketing people, and they later the salaries can be high, but always, you know. So the whereas the analyst job is something which I said 5%, 8% kind of jobs is somewhat like research oriented. You're sitting, you have some computers, you look at different databases and you continue to do what you are doing, let's say, in your PG kind of study. So that is where is the job scene. So now I just come to the last slide. This is a slide, I just took it from a survey. The survey has come in Economist recently. And the survey says, the summary of the survey is, see now if a, when I came to Bangalore, it was possible for us to get a site, it was possible to get a loan to repay that site in the salary that we used to get. Now what has happened is, suppose you join whatever, you get a salary of 3 lakhs. 3 lakhs in a year you get a salary. The bank gives you a housing loan of 5 times your annual salary, which is 15 lakhs. Now in 15 lakhs, where is the flat? Can you buy an apartment in Bangalore? So in case you buy, it will be far away. And by the time you come to your job, etc., you will really get fed up. So then you will think, maybe I should get married, then it will become 3 plus 3, which will become 6 lakhs. So maybe 30 lakhs will a little bit improve your chances of getting. So the first thing is, the policies of the last 30, 40 years have been such that youngsters are not getting, getting to lead their own life by having their own apartment at all. And just an apartment itself becomes a big dream, which is not really nice, but this is what is happening at the moment. You get an apartment, but you get it far away, but not in the city. And youngsters are the ones who will enjoy the city. The old people are going to be sitting in their house only, or walk just a short distance if they are still healthy to walk. So it's very unfortunate, but this is what is happening. The second, also in terms of, the way, if we make it easy for the youngsters to go anywhere, suppose the visa restrictions of all the countries are lifted, there are no visa restrictions, you want to go to New York, go, stay there. If that happens, then the world GDP will double. If the entry restrictions go away, immediately the economy picks up. So there are a lot of entry restrictions, both internationally as well as inside the country. China is worse in that sense, but even in India also, if you observe the real estate workers who have come in Bangalore now, if you see any new building, apartment building, all these workers, most of them, they all quite often are illegal immigrants from Bangladesh. You will not find a single local worker doing the work right now, because this is how the labor migration happens. So because they're illegal, they won't be able to get a government school, they cannot admit their children to government schools, etc. So even though we say we don't have full restrictions, there are restrictions anyway. So that happens to everybody. So what has happened is, the youth has been, now the demographic dividend, we need to train the youth and prepare them. I have given you somewhat scary or realistic picture, because it's not really optimistic unless we really do few things. But more than who should do that is the youth itself. Now what the youth is doing, many times youth, now in fact I buy a newspaper, I buy 3 newspapers in my house. And the only person who reads these newspapers, I myself read those newspapers. My 2 daughters, who youngsters, do not read them at all. I had to show them something and kind of forcefully make them read a tiny part, and that's all they read. So what is happening is, the youth are not taking part in the political system. Now we have a president who is 80 year old. We always have leaders who are more than 70, 75 and so on. Why should we have, when we are saying working age population is 15 to 64, it should end at 64 for everybody. So there should be no leaders beyond that, and there should be many more youth leaders. Since you are not participating in the politics, since you are not reading anything about it, you are only interested in some small things, or maybe a party hall or whatever what you are doing, but you need to get more interested in the politics. And this is not only for India, this is my prescription. What I am telling you is merely what that economist survey said. I am just giving you that one chart, but this is the survey, so it's not my prescription. So what it says is the youth must participate in the elections, they must have enough MLAs, only then the policies will be such that, you know, you are able to change them. Because as time passes, there are not going to be many children. You need to look after a lot of old people. And apart from the other costs, this will be a huge major cost. And that can be, you know. So what the survey says is the elders so far, not only in India, in many countries, elders have failed the youth. And it is for the youth now to take care of themselves. So that's what the survey is. I feel it's a very recommended reading as to what you should be doing. Thank you very much.